Welcome back, and in this lesson I want to talk in a little bit of detail about gateway load balancers. Now these are a relatively new addition to the load balancer family and are designed for very specific sets of use cases, which I'll cover in this lesson. Now we have a lot of architectural theory to cover, so let's jump in and get started straight away. Now before we talk about gateway load balancers, I want to step through the type of situation where you might choose to use one. Consider this architecture, the Categram application server in a public subnet communicating with the public internet. Now what's missing here is some kind of inspection-based security appliance, something which can check data for any exploits to protect our application server. Now if this is an important application, which it is because it involves cats, we can improve the architecture. We can add a security appliance, and this would be a transparent security device. It would sit in the flow of traffic inbound and outbound, transparently reviewing traffic as it enters the application from the public internet, so protecting the application against any known exploits, and then filtering any traffic on the way back out, for example, detecting and preventing any information leakage. Now this works well assuming that we don't really have to think about scaling. The issue comes when we grow or shrink our application. Remember, AWS pushes the concept of elasticity, where applications can grow and shrink based on increasing and decreasing load on a system. When you need to deal with a growing and shrinking number of application instances, and where this growth is extreme, you need an appropriate number of security appliances, and this can be complex and prone to failures. Now, this solution is tightly coupled, where the application and security instances are tied together. The failure of one can impact the other. It doesn't scale well even in a single application environment, and it's even more complex if you're trying to build multi-tenant applications. It's this type of situation where you need to use some kind of security appliance at scale and have flexibility around network architecture when you might choose to use a gateway load balancer. And over the remainder of this lesson, I want to step through what they do, how they function, and how to use them. A gateway load balancer is a product which AWS have developed to help you run and scale third-party security appliances, things such as firewalls, intrusion detection systems, or intrusion prevention systems, even data analysis tools. You might use these, for example, to perform inbound and outbound transparent traffic inspection or protection. Now, AWS have a lot of awesome networking products, but there are many large businesses who use third-party security and networking products. You might do this because you have existing skills on those products and want to use them inside AWS, or you might have a formal requirement to use those products, or a specific feature or set of features which only one specific vendor can deliver. So in those cases, you'll need to use a third-party appliance, and to do that at scale in a manageable way, you'll need to use a gateway load balancer. At a high level, a gateway load balancer has two major components. First, gateway load balancer endpoints, which run from a VPC where the traffic you want to monitor, filter, or control originates from or is destined to. So in the example, I'll be using the VPC where the Categram application instance is hosted. Now, gateway load balancer endpoints are much like interface endpoints within VPCs, which you've experienced so far, but with some key improvements which I'll talk about in a second. The other component is the gateway load balancer, or GWLB, itself, and this load balances packets across multiple backend instances, and these are just normal EC2 instances running security software. In order for this type of architecture to work, the gateway load balancer needs to forward packets without any alteration. The security appliance needs to review packets as they're sent or as they're received. After all, that's the whole point. These packets have source and destination IP addresses which might be okay on the original network, but which might not work on the network where the security appliances are hosted from. And so gateway load balancers use a protocol protocol called Genève, and this is a tunneling protocol. A tunnel is created between the gateway load balancer and the backend instances, so the security appliances. Packets are encapsulated and sent through this tunnel to the appliances. Now let's review this visually, which should help you understand how all of the components fit together. Let's say that we have a laptop and this is accessing the Catagram application. Now I'm keeping this simple for now and not including any VPC boundaries. I'll show you this in a moment. So traffic leaves this source laptop and moves into a VPC through an internet gateway and arrives at a gateway load balancer endpoint. So gateway load balancer endpoints, this is like a normal VPC interface endpoint with one major difference. It can be added to a route table as the next hop, and this allows it to be part of traffic flows controlled by that route table. So traffic via a route table is directed at this endpoint, and then the traffic flows through to a gateway load balancer. So gateway load balancers are layer 3 and 4 devices, similar in many ways to a network load balancer, but it integrates with gateway load balancer endpoints, and it encapsulates all traffic that it handles between it and the targets using the Genève protocol. And this means that packets are unaltered. They have the same source IP, destination IP, source port, destination port, and contents as when they were created and sent. This allows the security appliances to scan the packets, review them for any security issues, block them as required, perform analysis, or adjust them as needed. And when finished, the packets are returned over the same tunnel, encapsulated back to the load balancer, where the Genève encapsulation is removed, and then the packets move back to the gateway load balancer endpoint and through to the intended destination. Now, the benefits of this architecture are that gateway load balancers will load balance across security appliances, so you can horizontally scale. The gateway load balancer manages flow stickiness, so one flow of data will always use one appliance, and this is useful because it allows that appliance to monitor the state of flows through a system. It provides abstraction. It means that you can use multiple security appliances to provide resilience. If one of them fails, then packets are just moved over to another available security appliance. So in this way, it's much like other load balancers within AWS. Now, just before we finish up with this lesson, I wanted to provide a little bit more of a detailed, typical architecture where you might use a gateway load balancer. So this is the Catagram application. It's running in a pair of private subnets at the bottom behind an application load balancer, which is running in a pair of public subnets. Off to the right, we have a separate VPC running a set of security appliances inside an auto-scaling group, so this can grow and shrink based on load to the application. Now what I want to do now is to step through traffic flow through this architecture and show you how the gateway load balancer architecture works to ensure we can scale this security platform. So we start at the top with a client, which is accessing the web application. Now this flow is going to be arriving at the application load balancer, which uses public addressing, and so logically it first hits the internet gateway. The internet gateway is configured with an ingress route table, also known as a gateway route table, which influences what happens as traffic arrives at the VPC. In this case, our packets are destined for the public IP that the application load balancer on the right is using. The internet gateway first translates the destination public IP address onto the corresponding private IP of that application load balancer, and this will be running inside the 10.16.96.0/20 subnet. So this is the subnet where the application load balancer is running from. So the third route is used because it's the most specific route for the 10.16.96.0/20 range, and traffic is sent towards the gateway load balancer endpoint in the right availability zone. zone. Remember, gateway, load balancer endpoints are like interface endpoints, but they can be the targets within routes. So the gateway load balancer endpoint receives these packets and then moves these packets through to the gateway load balancer itself, which is running in the security VPC. At this point, the packets still have the original IP addressing, and normally this would be a problem, since the security VPC might be using a different, or maybe even conflicting, IP range. So while the source and destination addressing remains the same, the packets are encapsulated using the Genève protocol and sent through unaltered to the security appliance chosen by the gateway load balancer. The exact nature of the analysis which takes place depends on the security appliance, and that's one of the benefits of using a gateway load balancer. It just allows third-party appliances to be used in a scalable way. It doesn't inflict particular feature set on us as network engineers or architects. So once the analysis has happened, the packets are returned, encapsulated to the gateway load balancer. The encapsulation is stripped and returned via the endpoint to the Categram VPC. Since the original IP addressing is maintained, the route table on the top public subnet is used, which has a local route for the VPC CIDR range. This, as the most specific route available, is used, and packets flow through to the application load balancer, and from there through to the chosen application instance. And of course, this logic is decided upon by the application load balancer. Now, the return path uses the same logic. Data leaves the application instance in response to the initial communication from the laptop, and so it will return via the application load balancer. The load balancer is in a subnet which has a local route, but the default route goes towards the gateway load balancer endpoint in the same availability zone. Now, since traffic is going back to the client device who originally accessed the Categram application, it will have a public IP version 4 destination IP address, and so the default route will be used. This means the packets will flow back to the gateway load balancer endpoint, and then from there through to the gateway load balancer, where they'll be encapsulated, passed through to the appliances, then back to the load balancer, de-encapsulated, and passed back to the gateway load balancer endpoint. Once they're back at the gateway load balancer endpoint, the subnet which the gateway load balancer endpoints are in has the internet gateway as the default route, and so this will be used, and traffic moves through the internet gateway, where its source IP will be changed to the corresponding public one of the application load balancer, and then the data will be sent on through to the original client device. And that's it. Transparent, inline network security done in a scalable, resilient, and abstracted way. Now, I'm going to be talking more about some of the more nuanced features in other lessons, but for now, that's the basics covered of gateway load balancers. In terms of other architecture, they share many elements with network and application load balancers, including the target group architecture, but they have a very specific purpose: network security at scale. Now, with that being said, that's everything which I wanted to cover in this video, so go ahead and complete the lesson, and then when you're ready, I look forward to you joining me in the next.